that the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's mentioned in Sunan Tirmidhi, volume number 4, chapter number 60, hadith number 2517. Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that once a man, he asked the Prophet, should I tie it, that is my camel, and trust in Allah, or should I leave it, leave my camel and then trust in Allah? The Prophet said, tie it, tie your camel and then trust in Allah. That does not mean that you leave your camel and then say that I've got trust in Allah, tawakkullah, I've got trust in Allah. You can't leave your door open and then say, you know, I've got trust in Allah, no robber will come. You have to close your door and then trust in Allah. Trust in Allah is important, but also following the guidance of Allah is important. And for success, trust in Allah is the most important. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 160, if Allah helps you, none can overcome you. If Allah forsakes you, who is there then who can help you? So let the believers put their trust in Allah. Allah says in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 69, that if you strive in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will open up your pathways. Allah also says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse 43, and Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 7, Fas'alu ahli zikri in kuntum la ta'lamun. If you don't know, ask the person who is knowledgeable. Ask the one who possesses the message. So for success, first is trust in Allah. Number two is striving, doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number three is ask the person who knows. Even planning is important. Even goal setting is important. And we find when we read the books of management gurus, there are various goal settings that have been given by them. But for me, the best planning, the best goal setting is Islamic. I-S-L-A-M-I-C. I is for Islamic. Your goal should be according to the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Your goal should be based on the teachings of Quran and the teachings of Sahih Hadith of the last and final messenger Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It should be Islamic, number one. S, your goal should be specific. It should be focused. Your goal can't be vague. Let me give you an example. Once there was a teacher who was teaching archery to his students. And he tells his students who were learning bow and arrow, aim at that bird who's sitting on the treetop. All of them take aim. He said, don't release until I give you command. So he asked the first student, have you taken aim? He said, yes. What do you see? He says, I see the forest, I see the trees, and I also see the bird. He asked the second student, what do you see? He says, sir, I see the tree, I see the branch of the tree, and I see the bird. He asked the third student, what do you see? The third student replies, I only see the branch of the tree and the bird and the eye of the bird. He asked the fourth student, what do you see? The fourth student replies, sir, I only see the eye of the bird and nothing else. The teacher says, let the arrow go. And the arrow hits the eye of the bird. Your goal should be specific. It should be focused. It should not be like the traveler who wants to go nowhere, not like the dog who's running after a car without purpose. Number three, L. L is for lucrative. It should be profitable. Number one, it should be profitable in the hereafter, akhirah. And if possible, simultaneously, it can even be profitable in this world. But more important is akhirah. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 201, Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina azaban nar. Oh Lord, give us the good in this world and the hereafter, and save us from the torment of hellfire. So it should be lucrative, it should be profitable, number one in the hereafter, and then secondly in this world. But more important is the hereafter and then the world. Let not your profit of this world take you away from the profit of the hereafter. Fourth is A. A, it should be apt, it should be appropriate, it should be suitable. Your goal should be apt and appropriate. M is for measurable. Your goal should be measurable. And for your goal to be measurable, first it should be specific. After it is specific, it should also be measurable. For example, suppose the builder says, I want to build the tallest building in the world. The goal is specific. But to make it measurable, he does a survey. Which is the tallest building in the world? And he comes to know that Burj Al Khalifa, it is 828 meters tall. Specific. So now his goal is, he has to build a building which is more than 828 meters tall. It's specific and measurable. If it's measurable, it can be monitored. How much are you reaching? How much are you coming closer to your goal? I is for intention. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, chapter number 1, book of faith, hadith number 1. First hadith of Bukhari, innamal amalu binniyah. Your deeds will be judged on your intentions, and you'll be rewarded for your intentions. Your intention should be to please Allah and His Rasul, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Your intention should not be to become famous, to become popular. If that's your intention, then your goal is not correct. If your intention is to please Allah, your Creator, and His Messenger, surely you will be rewarded in the hereafter, and inshallah, Allah will reward you even in this world. It should be consistent till the time you achieve the goal, if the goal is time-bound. If it's not time-bound, it should be consistent forever. For example, if your goal is, I want to read Quran at least once in the month of Ramadan, so then you have a target. I will read one juz every day. Then you are consistent. Every day in the month of Ramadan, you read one juz of the Quran. At the end of Ramadan, you will finish the Quran at least once. If your goal is not time bound, maybe you want to say, I want to read the Quran daily. Then you set up a target. I will read Quran every day, half juz or maybe one juz. And then you start, the moment you achieve reading half juz or one juz a day, keep on being consistent till the end of your life. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, book of Salah, chapter number 272, hadith number 1711, he said that once a person asked the Prophet, which is the best of deeds which is loved by Allah? So the Prophet said, Allah loves those deeds which are done consistently, even if they are small. It is far better than bigger deeds which are done only once. So deeds which are done consistently are far superior than deeds which are done once in a while, even if they are greater. So the goal should be Islamic. I for Islamic, S for specific focused, L for lucrative profitable, A for apt appropriate, M for measurable, which can be monitored, I for intention, should be to please Allah, and C, it should be consistent.
Allahu Akbar. scientific notions in the glorious Quran are among its endless aspects that can testify for the divine nature of this noble book. These scientific notions are probably the best addressed to the people of our time. I am Zaghloul al-Najjar. Please join me in this program to discuss some aspects of the scientific notions in the glorious Quran.
Created the universe to him. Appreciate the word-to-word authenticity of scientific notions and proven facts mentioned in the glorious Quran 1400 years ago in Scientific Notions in the Glorious Quran. Every Saturday at 8 p.m. and repeat telecast at 8:30 a.m. India on Peace TV.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth? And who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch Truth Prevail and Lies Perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik. Every Sunday to Friday at 9 p.m. and repeat telecast at 7:30 a.m. India on Peace TV.
Let me give you an example. Some of us may be aware of the history of Wilma Rudolph. Wilma Rudolph was a girl who was born, and she had polio since childhood. And the doctors, they put braces on her legs. And they said, this girl will never set foot on the earth. Her mother, she encouraged the child, and she told Wilma, what you want to do, you will be able to do. And the mother encouraged her daughter. Wilma, at the age of 9, she removed the braces and she wanted to be the fastest woman on the earth. That was a desire, that was a goal. After removing the braces, at the age of 9, at the age of 13, for the first time in her life, she takes part in a race and she loses. She comes out last. But yet, she's consistent. She keeps on striving. She loses. Again, she strives. A day comes when she qualifies for the Olympics. And this is a true story. It's not an anecdote. It's not a fairy tale. Once she qualifies for the Olympics, in 1960 Olympics, she comes out first in 100 meters amongst the women. She gets the gold medal. She also gets the gold medal in 200 meter sprint amongst the women. She also wins the gold medal for the 400 meter relay, 100 into 4 amongst the women. She gets 3 gold medals in the 1960 Olympics. And she creates history. A paralytic woman who had polio, she becomes the fastest woman on the face of the earth in the year 1960. Now, when we analyze the goal setting done by Wilma, and if you have read books of the management gurus, She fulfilled all the criteria. Those who have read about the SMART goals, I don't want to go into detail. But let us verify how much she fulfills of the main target of the creator, Islamic. Number one, was the goal Islamic? Was the goal according to Quran and Sunnah? I don't know her personal life, but I knew that she was not a Muslim. I don't know whether she did for the creator or not. Number two, was the goal specific? Yes, it was specific. She wanted to be the fastest woman on the face of the earth. Was it lucrative? Was it profitable? Yes. For this world, it was profitable. She gets fame. She gets honor. But for the hereafter, Allahu Alam. I doubt whether in the hereafter, this Olympic gold medal will bring a profit. Unless she dedicates the gold medal towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A, was it apt and appropriate? Yes, it was. M, was it measurable? Yes, she could measure who is the fastest woman on the face of the earth. Maybe the timing is somewhere close to 9 seconds or 10 seconds or 11 seconds. Measurable. And she practiced, she achieved a goal. I, what was the intention? If intention was fame, surely she got it. Was the intention to please Allah? I doubt. C, was it consistent? Yes, it was consistent. She consistently practiced, even though she lost, till she won and became the fastest woman on the earth. Let me give you another example to compare and show the difference between goal setting. I would like to give an example of the man, of the person who had very small means but reached the heights in his field. The man, the person who changed my life and converted me from a doctor of a body to a doctor of soul. And I'm sure you know the name of that man. He's none other than Sheikh Ahmed Didad. Let us compare his goal setting. Sheikh Ahmed Didad. And if you know the life history of Sheikh Ahmed Didad, he acquired education only till standard 6. Because both his ends could not meet, he was forced to leave his education. After passing standard 6, he was forced to leave his education. A man with small means. He was forced to leave the country, India, where he was born. Then he goes to South Africa. He does a job of a salesman. He works in a furniture shop. He does the job of driving, etc. And while he was in South Africa, he used to constantly be harassed by the Christian missionaries, who used to tell, Islam is a useless religion. It is merciless. They used to attack Islam. And because he used to get harassed, a desire came in his heart that I want to reply all the allegations against Islam made by these Christian missionaries. I want to give a fitting reply to these Christian missionaries. Imagine a man only studied to standard 6. But naturally he had faith in Allah. He strived. He stumbled across a book. Books which were lying in a room which had dust on it. He stumbled across a book by the name of Izharul Haq, the truth revealed by Maulana Rahmatullah Karanvi. And he gets the direction for his goal. That's how he started. And he strived for 40 years till the time he challenged the stalwarts of Christianity. Imagine a 6th standard pass man strive for 40 years and challenge the stalwarts of the world. So much so that in 1986, he was about to debate Reverend Jimmy Swaggart. And at that time, in 1980s, Jimmy Swaggart was the number one, most powerful, most famous Christian televangelist. Just a few weeks before his debate, one of the fans of Sheikh Didat told him that, "Sheikh Ahmed Didat, I'm your fan, but I want to give you an advice. This man, Jimmy Swaggart, I know him. I've studied him. Please don't debate him. He will chew you and he will spit you out." Imagine a fan of Didat giving advice to Didat. "You don't debate this Jimmy Swaggart. You don't know him, I know him. He will chew you and he will spit you out." The person who was the most famous televangelist, who owned television channels, whose budget was more than $1 million a day to keep his head above water. Our Sheikh Ahmed Didat, mashallah. With Allah on his side, he goes to USA, in the hometown of that Christian missionary, in the country very famous. He goes and he has a debate. And alhamdulillah, summa alhamdulillah, with Allah's help, he turns the tables over. Imagine a man of small means, not even past school, leave aside being a graduate, challenges the stalwarts of Christianity, so much so that he became the biggest stumbling block for the Christianity of the world, for the Christian missionaries. One man alone, Sheikh Ahmed Didat, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he challenged the whole of Christianity. Let's analyze his goal setting. Number one, the Islamic. I. Was it Islamic? Was it according to Quran and Sahih Hadith? Was it for Allah and His Rasul? But naturally it was. That's the reason he was able to achieve his goal. Number two, was it specific? Yes. His goal was specific. I want to reply to the allegations against Islam. Specific. I want to give a fitting reply. Remove the misconceptions about Islam that is there in the minds of the non-Muslim. Number three, was it lucrative? Was it profitable? He wanted profit in Akhirah. And inshallah, inshallah, Allah will grant him Jannah, inshallah. But besides being profitable in the Akhirah, it even profited him here. You know, a number six standard passed man, in 1986, he gets the biggest award in the Muslim world. He is awarded the King Faisal Award for service in humanity. A sixth standard man. He didn't do for the award. Maybe he got $200,000. He didn't do it for that. Maybe for the gold King Faisal Award. He didn't do it for that. He did for Allah and His Rasul. Allah profits him in Akhirah and even in this world. Lucrative. A. Was it apt? Was it appropriate? Very apt. At the right time. His style, everything at that time. When the Christian missionaries were hammering the Muslims. Our morale was at the lowest. This man, Sheikh Ahmed Didat, he inspired thousands of youngsters, including myself. We could at least raise our head and stand. Apt. M. Was it measurable? Yes. What did he do? He collected the books of Christianity, the Christian missionaries who wrote against Islam. You know, John Gilchrist, all these books, Jimmy Swaggart, and started replying. When they attacked the Quran and Islam, he replied and he studied their scripture, Bible, used the verse of the Quran and implemented on them and he found results. Measurable. I. What was his intention? His intention wasn't to become famous. His intention wasn't to win the King Faisal Award. His intention was to please Allah and His Rasul. C. Was he consistent? Yes, he was. Imagine, he struggled and strived for 40 years. And if you know his history, his office was a small, dingy place. And he tells us that even to print a black and white pamphlet, 1,000 quantity, they used to have a meeting. Let's have a meeting. Can we print 1,000 quantity of a black and white pamphlet? MashaAllah. Consistent. Kept on striving. Till he reached his goal. The difference that we find in Wilma Rudolph and Sheikh Ahmed Didat is that the goal of Wilma Rudolph, it was short-sighted. It was more for this world. But the goal of Sheikh Ahmed Didat, it was far-sighted. And it was for the Akhirah. And inshallah, Allah will give him reward in the Akhirah and even give him reward in this world.